And from our side, a very warm welcome and Happy New Year, if I haven't greeted you in person yet. So we are looking towards the Lord and to the Lord to do great things for us personally, as a church, as a school, and as a ministry. And we're even believing for our country today. I've got a short text this morning, and Janine prayed it as well. 2 Chronicles 7:14, well-known scripture, but sometimes not a well-practiced scripture. And so we want to have a look at that this morning, 2 Chronicles 7:14. To give a little bit of context, it's similar to others such teachings and doctrine that we find in the Bible, and we especially find a more comprehensive thought in Deuteronomy 28 through to 30, for example, where God says to the Israelites, Moses says to them that while you obey the Lord, while you serve Him and honor Him and love Him, you're going to be blessed. You're the head and not the tail, the above and not beneath. God will bless you in the basket, He'll bless you in the field, and there'll be so much blessing that you'd not be able to contain it. But if you, on the other hand, as the people of God, turn away from the Lord, He will allow the enemy to come in. He'll cause you to flee from the enemy and so forth. But if again, if you carry on reading, and you'll be scattered throughout the lands, as we even see today. But if again you turn to the Lord and call upon Him, He will bring healing. And this is the background. This is the prayer of Solomon, where he prayed just prior to this for the dedication of the temple that was built. And the Lord appeared to him in the night. And again, the context is that if there's pestilence, if there's difficulty, if the enemy is coming in and you're under oppression, and then this invitation we have in 2 Chronicles 7:14. And I want to focus on this morning, and just a few things today, a few very, very important things today, especially as we gear up for our time of focused prayer in the coming 2 weeks. If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. A few things I want to touch on this morning, and over the past few weeks, especially in this new year, we've been sharing, and God has laid on my heart to share that we as His people need to reset sometimes. And sometimes we get all sorts of things that cling to us and actually hidden things. And the Lord is calling us to His people for renewal, for a reset, and that we can go forward in faith, just believing and confident without anything holding us back. As the Bible says, sin that weighs us down and anything that hinders us, we want to run our race with patience to the glory of God. And a wonderful way, in fact the best starting point, is through prayer, is through calling upon the Lord. And that's what we want to do, not only today but in the time to come as well. I've entitled the message this morning, Agents of Change. Agents of Change. Now, I just want to say up front here is that we don't just have to accept what the enemy dishes up to us in life. And I'll say that again. We don't just have to accept what the enemy, the devil, the world, crooked people, evil people, dish up to us and for us as the people of God. In fact, we as the people of God have been given the keys of the kingdom, the Lord says to us. Examples in Scripture are numerous, they are abundant, that we as the people of God hold the keys. And yet we say, now it's interesting, if my people, let us not wait for politicians to bring healing I can tell you, don't hold your breath. Okay. Once they're in the seat, sadly, and looting and so forth, not all of them, but that's what happens. They don't, once they've got the vote, they don't really care. They just care about themselves. Let's pray for government. The Bible says we do that, and that we can bring change. And uphold those, pray for elections, vote, all of those things. But don't put your confidence in man, the Bible says. It's a vain hope. But we don't just have to accept the status quo, the what people are doing, the way they're doing, the lies and the promises. And what the Word is saying here, we have an invitation to make a difference. We can be and are called, in fact, to be agents of change. That's why Jesus said a very similar thought. You're the light of the world. We are here to bring revelation to the world, the revelation of the gospel. You're the salt of the earth. We are here to influence our society. We are here to make an absolute difference. Now, I want us to see this morning at different levels. In our own lives, in our families, we can make a difference. In our church, the churches, in our communities, and broadly speaking, nationally, provincially, and even in the world, we are called as the people of God. Collectively, it's addressing the people of God, those who are called by my name. At that time, they were called Israel. Today, we are true Israel. We are called Christians. We are the people of God, and this promise is for us today. It's a wonderful promise. In fact, there's clear precedence in Scripture, clear history, that exactly as Moses, under the inspiration of the Spirit, said to the people, when the people served God, when they honored God, when they worshipped Him as God alone, the people were blessed. But when they turned away, when they started doing what the heathen or pagan nations around them and started worshipping foreign gods, God handed them over or allowed the enemy to come in. That wasn't His initial plan. And it's still not His initial plan that we should be dominated by the enemy, because we are created to put Him under our feet. We can resist Him. We can overcome Him personally. We can overcome Him in our families, in the church, and more broadly speaking. And so that's how we need to see it. But there's a clear pattern. But let's have a look. The first thing we see, if my people, this is a collective invitation. Not the word if. God doesn't say you better pray or else. It's an invitation for us to pray. Like this 2 weeks of prayer, it's an invitation to pray, a call to pray. Some of us may not be able to pray every night, every year. And I've also said you can fast as the Lord leads you. Again, I'm not saying fast for 2 weeks. I want to be very particular about that. As the Lord leads you, God might lead one person to fast a number of days. God might lead another person to fast for half a day or a day during the period. Okay, it's an invitation. It's up to you. I've got a problem sometimes when, and I've been around in Christian circles and had these discussions where there's a 40 or 21 day fasting and prayer announced, and you end up with a lot of guilty people most times. And many times they're trying to emulate Muslims. And it's interesting, once in, I'm going to get going, I don't want to deviate too much here, but we stayed in Kenya in Mombasa, which was a very Islamic place, for 2 years. We were invited by my boss, who was a Muslim, very nice guy. And it was the time of their fasting, okay? And they're fasting, you know, for the month or whatever. But we were invited to the feast in the evening. So I didn't know you have a feast in the evening, but you do. You fast from sun up until sun down. But after sun down, it's a big feast, okay? So I just thought about it. I thought, well, this is a good way of fasting. So many of these things sometimes can be an outward show. Just like Jesus said to the Pharisees, you know, you think because you fast twice a week that you do this and you do that and the other, that you're something. So fasting should never, and the word speaks about that, that the true fast of the Lord is obedience. It's love for one another. So we, but it's powerful. Okay, when we fast and we seek the God in prayer and fasting genuinely before the Lord, I can tell you, you can get wonderful breakthrough. Absolute wonderful breakthrough. So I hope that gives a little bit of a clarity. I'll share a little bit more in the 2 weeks just now on the way we'll do it. But we have an invitation to pray. If my people will humble themselves, humility is always associated with submission to God on the one hand, and on the other hand, exaltation by God. Whereas pride always goes before a fall, and pride is associated with arrogance, it's associated with disobedience, it's associated with trying to do things in my own strength and my own way. But humility, we are called upon this morning to have a heart of humility, because humility says, I cannot do it alone. I know, as I go into this year, personally, I cannot do this alone. Lord, I'm dependent on you. I'm dependent upon you for everything, for bodily strength, for spiritual strength. I'm dependent upon you not to become discouraged, to know what to do, when to do it, what to say, for your provision, for everything. I'm dependent upon you. So humility says, Lord, I want to submit to your will because you know better. You know far more. Your ways are far higher than mine. I can never even imagine your thoughts than my thoughts. Therefore, I submit myself to you, knowing that your plan and your purpose is best. That's why Jesus said in the natural, he knew what was coming on that terrible Roman cross when he was going to take the sin of the world. In the natural, it was an excruciating thing. You could imagine the tremendous pressure, so much pressure that he began to bleed, the Bible says. And that is an extreme medical condition that is actually known. But he says, not my will, but thy will be done. And as he prayed, the angels came and strengthened him. So it's not always easy, but as we humble ourselves, and I've found that and many years ago as a Christian, I said, Lord, not my will, your agenda first, what you want. If I move somewhere, what do you say about it? If I'm going to go take a position, Lord, what do you say about it? And so forth. Not my will. So humble themselves, a disposition of humility believes that God is sovereign. I've made a note here that he alone ultimately has the power to bring true healing and change. Humility, as I said, acknowledges our dependency upon God, that we cannot resolve deeper or broader challenges through our own means and strength. I've got to watch sometimes, because if I see the things happening in our country and what people do, in the natural, I can get very angry. I can get very mad about it and very frustrated. But I've got to say, Lord, how do we bring change? And the wonderful thing is we don't have to just accept what is dished out to it. And I'll come to that in a moment. We can say, Lord, you're sovereign. Lord, you set up one, you take down another, and ultimately we are waiting for your kingdom to come, where you're going to remove all earthly and worldly government, because none of it, it's all corrupt. Now again, I just want to say there are very, very good servants in government, maybe not as always as numerous and in certain positions, and they do serve sincerely, but broadly speaking, they are corrupt. Luke 14:11 says, for everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. So when we're talking about humility, when we humble ourselves, God is the one who lifts us up, and he promotes us. He exalts us. 1 Peter 5:5-6 says, likewise, you younger people, submit yourselves to your elders. Yes, all of you, be submissive to one another and be clothed with humility. Yeah, we have a beautiful picture. What a beautiful picture that is, to be clothed with humility. For God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. I can promise you, the word promises us that as we submit ourselves to his will, God is going to honor you. God is going to exalt you. Ultimately, we know that that is in glory, but he's going to exalt you. So let us not fear men. We know that Jesus humbled himself. He did not consider equality with God something to be held onto, but made himself of no reputation, being found in form of a man. He came and he humbled himself, became a bondservant, and humbled himself, and to even dying on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him a name above every other name, in heaven, on earth, and under the earth. Every knee will bow and declare him as Lord. Secondly, the people of God, I see here, are called to pray. They're called to pray. That speaks of a heart of communion with God. Prayer is a wonderful gift. It's a wonderful gift from God. On the one hand, it's a great privilege that through prayer, we get to know God. We get to listen to his voice. We get to see him answer many, many prayers. And I'm sure if I gave you opportunity to testify, you would do that. And I've seen in my own life, God just answers so many prayers, even on a daily basis sometimes. We see miracles happen. We see things change. We see unexpected things happen because God intervenes. So on the one hand, it's a wonderful privilege, a vehicle, if you like, a gift that we can communicate directly with the Lord through Christ and approach his throne of grace with confidence and boldness, knowing that his ears are open to our prayers, or the prayer of the righteous, as the word says. On the other hand, prayer is a powerful weapon. Listen, prayer is a powerful weapon to bring about change in the highest echelons of government through prayer. God can heal nations, and this is what he says. You know, as you pray, I'm going to heal the nation. I'll bring true healing. So prayer is a mighty and effective means by which God has given to believers to make available his power, his wisdom, and a means to change things. Agents of change. James 5:16 says, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. It's not just for nothing we pray. We pray because we believe prayer absolutely makes a difference. On the other hand, we need to ask the question, can any man, woman, young person afford not to pray? And the answer is no. According to Jesus, no man can afford not to pray. We know the scripture, Matthew 26, when he was in the garden, he rebuked or admonished the disciples. They were weary. They didn't fully understand what was happening. He says, what could you not watch with me for 1 hour? Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. So it takes sacrifice to pray. It's sometimes we're feeling tired. Sometimes the devil will keep us busy with many, many things that we just don't find time. But we need to be intentional. We need to be determined because we cannot afford not to pray. Luke 21:36, in context of the last days, the Lord says, watch therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. I don't know what this year is going to bring. We know in context of the last times, we can see we're going to have more of that. And the Bible tells us that. But let us be ready. Let us not be caught off guard. Let us be forewarned, I say, is to be forearmed. Okay, so let us just watch and pray and not be caught unawares of the things, and God will keep us and uphold us during these times. Thirdly, we see seek my face. Seek my face. This speaks of a heart after God. Let me give you a personal example. Hannah prayed. Hannah in the Old Testament, the mother of Samuel, the wife of Elkanah, if I get the husband's name correct. She prayed. She didn't have a child. And the other wife was constantly goading and tormenting her and provoking her because she had children. There were two wives. And this carried on. And every year when they went up to sacrifice, it says Hannah continued to pray. And so much so that Eli, the high priest, thought that she was drunk and actually rebuked her because she was praying silently. And I just want to say, when we come and pray, don't always think you have to pray big loud prayers, or you can just find a place and pray silently. God knows our hearts. Okay, we can pray audibly. But Hannah prayed and told Eli what she was believing for. And Eli, as the high priest, blessed her once he found out what was that. And we know that there was a breakthrough. Samuel was born, and later on other children as well. And we know that Samuel became one of the mightiest prophets that there were. That's seeking, that's persevering in prayer. I found that it's good to learn to pray through. I know we can pray anywhere, and it's good to send up little telegram messages, which we have to do now and again. But we need good times of prayer where we can actually pray through. We can just wait upon God, and there's almost like a spiritual release. We can sense if my prayers have gotten through. Because sometimes we've got to quieten ourselves. There's the busyness of work, the busyness of day, everything. And we just got to get quiet before the Lord and get focused upon the Lord. And as we pray and as we begin to seek the face of the Lord and wait upon Him, we can get the breakthrough. We can absolutely get the breakthrough. Daniel, Hannah personal, Daniel prayed for the nation. Daniel sought the Lord, and we know that he was fasting. Well, he was on a vegetable water fast, 21 days. He sought the Lord, and the word says, upon the day that he had set his heart to pray, he was already heard. But there was war. You see, when we begin to pray, when we begin to intercede, as Daniel did, it ignites spiritual warfare in the heavenlies, and that's behind the scenes. And so we ignite, if you like, and the angels of the Lord war with the evil angels and start moving and gaining territory in the spiritual realm. I don't want to go into too much of that. That's a teaching on itself, but certainly as we begin to seek the Lord for that breakthrough, it ignites spiritual battles, because our battle is not against flesh and blood. Okay, it's against the powers and principalities in the heavenly places, and that's why we need to pray through. So Daniel sought the Lord and received divine revelation and strength to live victoriously despite overwhelming odds, him and his friends. We know Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were also cast into the furnace, where they saw the fourth man in the fire and miraculously delivered. Was through prayer. It was through prayer. And Daniel was delivered from the lion's den. He was submissive. He wasn't rattled. He wasn't worried. And sometimes we think we got it hard in our country. They had it very, very hard. They were captives, taken captive by a pagan nation against overwhelming odds, where that if you did not obey, you would be executed. You could be tortured. Okay, but yet they pray and they receive wonderful victory despite the odds. The church in Acts, I'm just giving you a few examples of seeking the Lord in prayer. In Acts chapter 12, it says that Herod arrested James, the brother of John, and executed him, and that appeased the people, obviously the Pharisees, Sadducees, and so forth. So he proceeded to seize Peter also, but because it was the Passover, he put him in jail. It says that he had two Roman soldiers. Peter was tied and chained to them in the dungeon. But it says the church, the house church, listen, just a group, maybe not many saints. The saints were praying. It says, but the church prayed. You see, the devil's got a plan. The devil's got a plan. Jesus said, he's come not to steal, kill and to destroy, but I have come. I've got a better plan to give life and life more abundantly. And again, the church didn't just accept this. They saw what was happening, and they decided just to seek the Lord. And it says the church prayed constantly. The church prayed earnestly, and Peter was visited by an angel. The chains were broken. The iron doors were open, and Peter was miraculously delivered. We don't have to just accept the status quo and what people are saying and their vision for our country and for the people of this nation. We can rather believe and say, Lord, I'm believing for your peace. I'm believing for your purposes. I'm believing for the gospel. I'm believing for change. And we can absolutely make a difference. I said briefly, certain breakthroughs come by prayer and with fasting. And I've seen that in my own life as well, that especially in major decisions and leading. And it's good to fast when you want breakthrough, when you want clarity and those things. Fourthly, the people of God over here, if my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, means repentance. Okay, repentance means to turn from something. We can say I'm sorry, but sorry is not good enough. And we need to take the sorry further and turn around and do the right thing. Whereas we are walking away from God, we need to turn to God and walk to God. That is repentance. It means actually a change of mind. It means to no longer do or walk the ways that we, the devious ways we were walking in, and now walk and become a follower of Christ. Turn from the wicked ways. Now the question is, when you read the scripture, can the people of God be wicked? I mean, that's a powerful word. Evil and wickedness is probably the two worst words or most striking words to describe bad things. According to the Bible, yes, the people of God. This is the people of God. If my people, it's not speaking to the evil. We're going to wait a long, long time if we're waiting for the heathen to heal themselves. They're going to just do as sinners do. That's the problem, sin. They need to be told the gospel and repent of their sin. We have the keys, but the people of God, according to Scripture, can walk in wicked ways. I enjoy studying the Scripture, and it's always sort of caught my attention, wicked. You know, and if one has a look at the root of the word, it's quite interesting. Obviously, it means bad. It means evil and all sorts of evil things, which, according to this, Christians can walk in. But it means broken. That's an interesting thing. It means broken. And if you consider the context of the scripture, we have broken on the one hand and healing on the other hand. And there we see, so wickedness is broken. It means displeasing. That the people of God can begin walking in ways that do not please Him, that grieve the Spirit, that are displeasing. Carnal ways, even, as we read in Corinthians. We can be carnal Christians. And those ways are wickedness. It also means sad. So it means bad, evil, broken, displeasing, and sad. And obviously, if there's brokenness, we will be sad. We'll lose our joy. And we won't be happy or feel blessed anymore at all. We can deviate from the paths of righteousness, create idols of greed and materialism, lose our first love, grow cold in our faith, lose our passion and zeal, become lukewarm, half-hearted, double-minded, carnal, worldly, serving the flesh. There can be moral failures, losing focus of what really matters to God. And so all of these things, these behaviors, these situations or the state can be described accurately as wickedness. And therefore the Bible says that. But we have a blessed invitation not to continue, but to turn. To turn from the wicked ways. Just like we see in Revelation, I think I touched on it last week, the lukewarm church where they thought they had it all, but they were blind, naked, miserable, poor, could no longer see. But Jesus invited them. He said, as many as I love, I rebuke, I correct, I chasten. Repent, therefore. Repent, be encouraged, repent. So we have the opportunity to turn. We don't have to continue in those ways, whether it be on a personal level, a family situation, or whatever it is, a church situation, we can turn and repent. And we notice then, now there are some blessings which I want to conclude. It's, the Lord says, then will I hear from heaven. Not before that. I'm looking for my people to pray. I'm looking for humility, pray in humility. I'm looking for them to seek my face. I'm looking for repentance. Then will I hear from heaven. Then will I hear from heaven. The hearing or the response is the act of God, but it's also conditional to our faith and obedience. And we need to understand that as the people of God. I'm saying this, and the word is saying that, that we can grow in our faith, that we can pray more effectively, and that we can get the breakthrough that we're looking for. God's ears are open to the prayer of anyone, know the righteous. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much, and we know the scriptures. 1 John 3, 22-23 says, and whatever we ask, speaking to us as the people, whatever you ask, whatever I ask, we receive from him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And there you can see the pleasing or displeasing has direct effect on the answer of God to our prayers, as we see over here. I'll forgive their sins. I love Psalm 103:11-13. And as we repent, as we turn to the Lord, no matter where we've been, no matter what we've done, maybe we've grown cold in our faith or backslidden or doing some things aloud, displeasing things. But if we return to the Lord in true repentance, he'll forgive our sins. Psalm 103:11-13 says, for as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy towards those who fear him. In other words, those who revere him, those who honor him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. Wonderful promise. God's forgiveness is complete. When we repent in sincerity, confess our sins, he will remove them from us. We don't have to carry them, the past, around with us any longer. We can leave those bad experiences. We can leave those failures behind, and we can look forward to a new and greater season. I will heal their land. Healing in Scripture, sadly, many times we limit it to bodily healing. Now, bodily healing is important, but healing in Scripture, yeah, we have healing of the land. We sung this morning, heal the brokenhearted. Healing has a far more wider meaning than just healing of the body. Sometimes we're looking for healing of the body, but God wants to prosper and heal our soul and our heart first. I will heal their land. I will make it whole again. I'll bring restoration, restitution, revival, true spiritual worship, sincere love, doing the will of God. I'll bring peace, the Lord says, as we pray for our country and our leaders, that you might live in peace. So healing, we need to see in a broader context, if you like. And perhaps you need healing in your family. Perhaps you have broken relationships. Perhaps there are many disappointments, and we can pray and say, Lord, I'm believing you for healing for the situation, whether it be for ourselves, for our loved ones. Perhaps you know of others who need healing. You can pray with them that there can be a deeper healing. Certainly for our country, we can pray for our leaders and pray for our land that God will bring. He's the only one. He's sovereign. He's the only one who knows how to bring healing and the one who can work in the hearts of men and women to bring about that vital change. Healing what is broken. False religion, and I want to conclude with this, I said it last week, believes that we need to do in order to be. True religion, the gospel says we need to be doing flows from our being. And again, if we look at this over here, God is not calling his people so much to do. He starts off by asking them who to be. Be humble. Be a person who seeks my face, who waits upon me. Be one who communicates and communes with me regularly. Turn in repentance. Turn from your old ways. And as we become the person that Christ has made us to be and begin to walk worthily of that call, the other things will fall into place. The healing will come. The prayers will be answered. Situations will change. And we're just believing for that, not only this morning, but for the 2 weeks ahead. And not only the 2 weeks, but in the season to come. Let's approach the Lord in faith. Now, I just want to say a little about the prayer. What we'll do is from 6 to 7, and I'm not saying it's the only time you need to pray, but mornings pray as well, and you can do that, but we'd want to pray corporately together as a community and give the opportunity to do so. From Mondays to Fridays, the church will be open 6 to 7 p.m. We'll start with just a short scripture reading. If there's any testimony, you can give a testimony. If there's any special requests, and we can have an opening prayer as a group, and then we can just move around and pray. And so if you come a little later, you might just find everyone praying. Or you can sit and pray together. And come when you can. We want to invite you to do that. And we know that everyone can't make it every night, and that's fine. But come, we want to invite you. We will be here. It will be open. And come and pray. And just allow the Lord to lead you. And let's stand together as a people of faith. And if you can't pray at that specific hour, and then just pray with us. And let's just believe as this particular ministry, God has called us here for such a time as this. And let's just stand in faith, believing for the good things, the great things that God is going to do. And I think above all, just to draw closer to the Lord. It's not so much about a grocery list. It's just drawing near to God, seeking his face. I know so many of the things we then worry about will just fall into place. So that's what we're believing for. Let us bow our heads this morning. Father, we thank you today, Lord, for the great and precious privilege, Lord, to come to your word, to be reminded of these ancient words, these truths, Lord, that never change. As we see many heroes of faith and many have gone before us and continue, how they've prevailed through prayer, through seeking your face, through humbling themselves. And Lord, we desire to do that ourselves. And so, Father, we just commit the 2 weeks coming to you. We pray for your help. We pray for your leading, Lord. And thank you for a joyous time as well. And Lord, that we can come with expectant hearts and faith, Lord. Thank you that you hold the future. Our confidence is in you. It's not in man. It's not in anyone else, Father, but our confidence, our faith is in you for the future. And we thank you for this now. We give you thanks for all that you have done. I thank you for each one who's come here this morning, that they love you. Bless them in their families, their situations, their work situations, Lord. And I just pray for a wonderful year filled with your purposes ahead for each one of them today. For those in the podcast also, we bless them this morning. We give you thanks. We give you praise now in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for listening. And at this time, we're going to invite the worship team up. We do appreciate them and the work that they do and also the preparation in the morning. So if you would come up, and then maybe I can just ask Dylan and Moses if you'd help, if you brought something you'd like to, or Janine, maybe Janine and Dylan, if you would just help with the offering.